Pastor, you know that. You know, I just want to. A lot of times, I think we really fall into a rut in our lives simply because we don't see the blessings that we have in our lives already. You know, as I'm looking over my shoulder, and you guys are singing and just you guys are at a retreat. You know, I haven't really been at a retreat in a long time, at least just for myself and actually just worshiping and things like that. Like little things like that, growing up in a church is a huge blessing. To come before God and be like, God, like I want to get out of a rut and live for you, like that mindset in and of itself is a huge blessing that most people don't have. And you know, I look back and you know, being back in a kind of a EM Korean church setting that I grew up in, and you know, I look to the first generation and see how much they've invested into my life, the spirituality that I have, and different people that really walk with me in my own faith. Sometimes I come and I complain to God, but if you just kind of like stop for a moment, you're like, dang, I stand here and worship because God has blessed me in my life. And I really hope that all of you in this room will be able to recognize that. Yes, you know, we want more, we're hungry for more, we would like to see more in our lives, but for a moment, just to thank God for all that he has given to us up to this point. I mean, the Christian walk and the Christian life is, it comes in seasons, you know, like every time I sit down and I pray over a sermon and contemplate on what to preach on, sometimes I'm like, do I go up there and challenge them, yell at them, what do I do, like, do I comfort their souls if they're hurt? And I realize, like, you know, we need all of it because there's different seasons of our life. There is. I'm not really sure what season of your life you're in right now, but I pray that God may speak to you and God may work in you. God may send people in your life that can guide you in it. But one thing that I learned over and over again is everything is a gift from God. Our lives is a gift from God. Our faith is a gift from God. We're really called to steward it. I mean, it's a gift that has been given to us, and we're called to steward it, to care for it, and even train it at times. Faith is a gift from God. It's not, you know, we don't come to God and be like, all right, God, I'm smart enough to understand this gospel thing, and I believe I got it now. No, it's a gift. The Holy Spirit opens up your eyes, and the fact that you can be like, oh my gosh, I see you, Jesus, is a gift. Amen. Our faith is a gift. Your gifts are a gift. Your gift, your talents are a gift. Your life is a gift. And we should never, never forget that. Our passage today is going to come from Romans chapter 12, 1 through 8. Romans chapter 12, 1 through 8. Do I sound muffled? No? Yeah, is this me? It's like my ears. Romans chapter 12, 1 through 8. I'm actually going to be jumping into a lot of different passages throughout. You know, as I was writing these sermons, I was like, man, I want to do this, do that. And I hope it all kind of comes together. But Romans chapter 12, 1 through 8, I'll read this to you guys. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your worship, spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them, if prophecy, in proportion to our faith, if service, in our serving, the one who teaches in his teaching, the one who exhorts in his exhortation, and the one who contributes in generosity, the one who leads with zeal, and the one who does acts of mercy with cheerfulness. Word of the Lord. Let's pray. Dear God, I just thank you so much just for the opportunity to worship you. I thank you so much for the inklings in our heart that goes to you, O Lord. I thank you so much just for the hunger to grow and the hunger to get out of a rut or in the norms of our life, to really live a life for you. Dear God, every step of the way may you challenge and mold and shape us, O Lord, into the men and women that you want us to be. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be holy and pleasing to you, Lord. May your gospel be preached, and may your Holy Spirit move in our hearts. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In continuation with last night's message, I hope you remember that we are all made for a specific purpose in life, and we must understand who we are and how God has designed us to be able to train ourselves in a way that we can be used for his kingdom, to live out our calling. I mean, if we really think about it, our bodies, our personalities, our God-given gifts are not our own. They're not our own. They're not to use for ourselves. It's there for us to care for it and train it for God's kingdom. This is why Paul, after chapters and chapters in the letter to the Romans, talking about the great works of Jesus and the salvation we have in him, he calls us to give our lives to God. Check this out in verse 1. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Paul is basically saying you were bought with an expensive price. Jesus bought you with his blood, and it wasn't cheap. These are the mercies of God that's talked about in the gospel. And we were destined for death and destruction because of our sins, yet God chooses to hold that wrath away from us and saves us. And this is really important to be able to understand why we are called to live for God. You know, when Apostle Paul said living sacrifice, most people were pretty confused. They're like, living sacrifice? What the heck does that mean? All throughout the Old Testament, they're used to dead sacrifices. Someone dies. An animal dies on behalf of somebody's sin. It dies, and that was the act of worship would come. But Paul's like, yo, you got to be a living sacrifice. And it's basically saying our whole lives, the way we do everything, is an act of worship. Paul challenges Christians to be living sacrifices and change everything. In our living, in our work, in our studying, it's all an act of worship. You know, I used to think it was so respectable and tough to say this, God, I will die for you. You know, and you know, when I was like in seminary, or even when I was just like sitting in my college years, I was like, man, you know, you hear of stories of martyrs. I'm like, I just wish that dude would come up to me with a gun to my head and be like, deny Christ and I'll shoot you. I'd be like, yo, do it, man. And I'll go down in history, maybe, as a guy that lived for Christ, or a guy that died for Christ. And I remember one of my friends, he was just like, I said this to him, he was laughing. He was like, yo, what if the dude went up to you, put a gun to your head, and said, I will castrate you and make you a eunuch? Would you do that for Christ? I was like, oh. I was like, yo, dude, I just fight my way out to make you a eunuch. But this shows us something. We can be like, yo, I'll die for you, Christ. I'll die for you. But how much harder is it to live for somebody? You know, this is why, if a guy ever tells you, yo, girl, I'll take a bullet for you. For you guys that are going to say, I'll take a bullet for you. Look them back in the straight of the eyes and say this. Say, I don't need that. I'd rather have a man who can live and care for me. I'd rather you be a man that will wash the dishes and do the laundry, change the diapers when we have children. I'd rather you be a man that can give up your past life as a single bachelor. A guy that doesn't look at other women will only look at me. That will give up the wild parties, a man who values his family more than himself. Yeah, I need a man that will die for me. I need a man that will live for me. It's living for someone that is so much harder. To live a Christian life means that you will die to your own living. Die to your own living. Die to your own ideas that you have this control over your life. Dying to all that and giving it to Christ. It means telling God that he can take control and do with it what he may. That you trust him enough that not only that he will use you for a bigger purpose, but for whatever plans that he has is actually better for you. Paul's telling us that we first need to understand that our lives are no longer our own, and we're called to steward it. And then Apostle Paul continues. He says this: do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. And this goes back to the whole thing yesterday, to renew the mind, to change our minds and be able to see the world in a different way. Guys, everything, faith, in the most simplistic way, is the way you see everything. It's the way you see everything. The way you see life, the way you see the world. You can either see God in it, or you can see God not in it. But if we actually see the world with God in it, it changes the way we live. We begin to live for God's will. And God is always bringing the world back into life. Things that were dead, He's bringing back to life. And He's telling us to be a part of this. But along with that, He also goes into talking about discerning ourselves. Not knowing ourselves and not knowing our calling is to miss out on our gifts. Therefore, we are called to discover our calling and steward our lives carefully and diligently for the kingdom. I mean, if some of you are in this room, maybe you've been working a job for a while and now you're getting tired. I'm like, is this really life? Like, am I supposed to be doing this for the rest of my life? Or maybe some of you in this room never worked a day in your life yet, but you're like, what should I do? And work. I think this is a constant feeling, man. I know people that are really old that are like, man, what am I going to do with change? I'm like, man, like, am I going to feel that way too? They ask the pastor, I'm like, what am I going to change? And I'm like, we juggle with it. Don't be discouraged if you are. I mean, I think it's our life. It's our life to really struggle with this and figure it out. But to give our bodies as a living sacrifice to God is to faithfully steward our gifts and talents for God's kingdom in whatever shape or form. And Paul talks about discerning our gifts, he says this: we got to think soberly about who we are. Verse 3 says this: for by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned us. Sober judgment according to the measure of someone's faith that God has assigned means that we got to look at ourselves with humility, yet with confidence. Humility because we're not perfect people and we all have limitations, and confidence because we have a great God. Sober judgment. This is sound judgment. Self-control judgment. I know we live in a world these days that you know, they said that everybody in this world right now, or mostly our generation, because we grew up with this mindset, we're a little depressed. Because this, our whole lives, we've been said, yo, pursue your dreams, you can be anything that you want. But then you actually go into the world and you can't be anything you want. No matter how hard I try, I'm not going to be a part of the Philadelphia Eagles, or I'm not going to be an NBA superstar. No matter how hard I try. I mean, I can't even touch the rim when I jump. Like, it's just not going to happen. But I think there needs to be some kind of humility to know ourselves, know what we can do, and bring it all to God. Got to be real with it. And then he goes on in verse 4 to say, for as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function. So we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another, having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, and blah, 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 goes on to name a bunch of them. I want to just leave you guys with just five different categories on actually how to think about what type of ministries we can do, and then I'm going to jump into how we can train them. These five things. I came across a book called SHAPE, S-H-A-P-E. It's an acronym talking about different ways that we can kind of look into ourselves. I'm not going to spend a bunch of time with it. I'm just going to give you guys as some tools to actually think about. One is spiritual gifts. Two, which is H, is heart passions. A is abilities and skills. P is personality. And E is experiences. Spiritual gifts are talents that have been given to God for the ministry, to edify the community. I mean, these are the ones that are stated in Scripture, right? Prophecy, teaching, serving, encouraging, giving, leadership, generosity, mercy, wisdom. I never knew wisdom was a gift, but it's awesome. Wisdom, knowledge, discernment, speaking of tongues, interpretation of tongues, helping people, compassion. Did you guys know that? And faith and healing and these different spiritual gifts that people have that they can bring to the plate. The second, maybe this might be something that you guys might get a little bit easier. But what grips your heart's passion? A lot of times, the places that we can serve God is what moves our heart. I mean, what makes your heart beat faster? How would you answer this question? If you can change one thing in this world and you have all the money to do it, what would it be? And it's not some kind of self-centered thing where, like, I'm going to buy a mansion. I mean, if you could actually make the world a better place and you have all the resources for it, what would it be? You know, one of my friends, like, everything he does is, like, he's been on this sex trafficking rampage where, not that he's doing it, that he's so passionate about it and fighting against it. Literally, like, he's been doing fundraisers after fundraisers, writing letters to the UN and talking about it all the time and joining a church that would fight that type of ministry. I mean, that's, like, his heart passion. He's like, I'm going to do something with that one day. A lot of the time, what burdens your heart? That could be the ministry that you're a part of. The third category is the abilities. What are your actual abilities? What are you good at? I mean, if you suck at math, you're not going to help and tutor people in math. Like, that's just not going to happen, right? What are your God-given abilities, things that you can do? Do you have organizational skills, music skills? All these things can be used for God's kingdom. Number four, personality. Our temperaments, introverts, extroverts, the way we think. Do we think emotionally, logically? Do we like to perceive things? Do we like to judge things? Or just kind of another factor, and experiences. I think experiences is probably one of the biggest things. I mean, the experiences kind of mold and shape a lot of the other things that we go through, right? How many ministries have popped up? How many ministries have popped up from a different hurt in our life in the past? Everything in our life is used. The major that we studied, the jobs that we had, the problems and hurts and thorns that we've had, the trials that we've gone through. I learned this in ministry. God does not waste anything. All of our experiences are used. All of them. You know, when I was younger, I used to like freestyle rapping. God used that so much in different ways. Like, I'm connected with different people. I can freestyle. You guys didn't know.
Let's hear it.
Don't ignore your past, but use it. Don't be ashamed of it. Let it be redeemed. I mean, these are just simple ways that you can find your ministry. But on the flip side, that's what I wanted to dig into today. There's a distinction between not having a gift versus laziness to develop and train yourself. There's a big distinction, especially even in our own faith. Yes, God gives us faith as a gift, but it's something that we're called to develop. Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 9:27 says this, I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. In the NIV, you know what he actually says? He says, no, I beat my body and make it my slave. Beat my body. This is the word discipline in Greek. I'm not going to even try to say that. It means to beat black and blue, meaning that it's hard work. It's hard work. You beat it into your body. Make yourself useful for God. You know, I don't really like talking about these like these graphic terms. I'd rather come to you guys and be like, it's all about grace. But you know what I learned in life? Anything that's worth fighting for, you beat your body for it because of that heart that God gave you for it. You know, these days in our generation, most people these days are trying rather than training. We try things out rather than pursue things with our entire heart. We're not willing to do what it takes. You know, I'm thinking this is like a cultural and general phenomenon. I mean, I've been working with young adults and college students, and even my friends, yo, we're a generation of flakes. Yo, I'm like text messaging, yo, this, it made it so easy. You gonna be there? Yeah, maybe. Oh, yo, I can't make it last minute, I'm sick. You know, just, you can't even argue, like, it's a text, and you're like, we're a generation of flakes. There's so many different career changes that somebody goes through. I mean, there's like statistics on it. Like, man, people change jobs every like twice a year or something, especially in the younger ages, and it keeps going. You know, back in the day, people were born into their career, so they only had one option, so they stuck with it. Now we have like a buffet of options. We're like, what do I do? Do I do this? Do I do that? Oh my gosh, like, it tastes good. And you guys go to a buffet, and you know, you take one bite of everything and not eat anything and throw it all away. But I feel like a lot of times this is what's happening, even in our own lives, in our own walks, and the things that we're doing. But if you really think about it, if you want to get better at something, there's always a lot of hard work and training. And training never feels good.
Any field has a crucible of learning where you are molded for that work. I mean, think about it. Everybody wants good things. Dudes want beach bodies. That doesn't come cheap, right? Or easy. You got to go to the gym every morning. You got to watch what you eat. You got to eat like chicken breast and broccoli. That's like the nastiest thing, and you got to eat that. If you want money, it takes work, musical skills. If you have any musical skills, how many hours did you have to put into those musical skills to actually make it happen, to actually make work, make music coming out? Training and discipline are required. But a lot of times we lose or give up. And a lot of times, even in the things of faith, I mean, there's got to be at least a little more to do with our walk and being like Jesus and living for his kingdom than just trying it out. It has to be a little bit more. Please be good stewards of the gift that God has given you. I mean, there are natural challenges, but most of the time, there's diamonds in the rough that we got to bring out. Now, I'm going to talk about just a few things on I guess, my suggestions and things that I think that Scripture talks about on how we can actually train our bodies and train our faith that are general enough to fit into every category. One is this, and these are some of the principles that I've learned when I was in L.A., and a lot of my mentor was, like, shoving these down my throat, and I thank God for it. Thank God for him. The pastor that I am today is only because I had people invest in me, training me, and really speaking truth into my life. One is this: be faithful in the small things. Be faithful in the small things. Don't forget this one. Be faithful in the small things. In Luke chapter 16:10, it says this: one who is faithful in very little is also faithful in much. And one who is dishonest in very little is also dishonest in much. This is actually a passage taken out of a parable called, the dishonest, like, worker or something. And he basically cheats everybody and gets money for himself, like, cheats his master or something. And I was like, why is Jesus telling us to be like this guy? But Jesus is basically saying this: even people in the world, when they have a goal, they will be shrewd in getting money to keep it. And then he's looking at people in like, the ministry world, and he's saying, hey, the least we can do is to work on something, to be faithful in the things that we want to have. Faithful in the good things for God. And he's talking about these things. I mean, I think in our generation, right, we all want to start off big. We want big paychecks. We want high-position jobs. We want big houses. We want nice toys. We see the rich young CEO that made Uber, and you're like, yo, I'm going to be uber rich one day. Or these guys that are just, you know, they're like pooping out money at the age of 23, and you're like, what the heck did they do? What am I doing with my own life? And things like that. We see these guys, but the truth remains. Responsibility in high positions in a career don't come to people who cannot handle the responsibility. And to learn that responsibility and skill, it takes a lifetime. It's the reason why mentors and elders are so important, because they take their decades of experience and pass it on to the young apprentices. But in order to get good at big things, you need to learn the small things. Any of you guys that have trained for something, you guys know this. If you want to play a song for guitar, you got to practice each chord and be faithful to each little string and hold it down tight so no other sounds come in. And only after you get that can you actually play a song without people holding your ears. And I used to play guitar at home so much, and my sisters used to always yell at me, like, but you suck. Studying everything. I have so many friends that dropped out of high school, and they were telling me, they're like, I will never be able to study because I can't read for more than 5 minutes. I was like, yeah, dude, read for 5 minutes every single day for a year, you'll get better. I'm still relatively young, but I'm beginning to see these trends. Those that are faithful in small things tend to later become responsible for big things. And those that tend to try to get big things right away, neglecting the small things, end up nowhere. You know, my mother, I'm actually really, really, really proud of her. She was awarded number one medical office in the state of Pennsylvania for, I don't know, like 5 consecutive years or something like that. My mom, she still speaks with an accent, not that good in Korean. And I'm
just like, dude, come on, like, what the heck? And she has, like, literally, like, 10 times, like, the amount of patients that she has is, like, 10 times the amount of most offices with single doctors. And I was just talking to her. I was like, that's pretty crazy. And then she was telling me her story. She was talking to me about it. She began to share and reflect with me, and she firmly believes that God has blessed her by making her a pastor's wife in the past. She said, "When back in the day when she was at church, people would always come to her and ask her for free prescriptions and talk about medical advice. So, yo, every time we went to church, I kid you not, I remember that we couldn't go home right away. I mean, I had to sit there for an hour waiting for her because she had a lot of people that wanted to see her." And she was like, "I hated it, but I was faithful to it." And she was like, "All right, it's whatever. It's just an hour." And she would sit down. And she was like, "You know what? You see the same sickness over 100 times for free. You can name that sickness before anybody tells you what's wrong with them just by looking at their face." And she was like, "Oh my!" She was like, "That was a gift to me. A gift to me." She said, "First, it was real frustrating because there was no real benefits to it. It's more work for her. She's tired." But later, she was like, "Yo, I realized being faithful in the small things. Though each person that she helped in the past brought 10 more people to her office just because of it." Crazy, crazy thing. It's the small treatments, those small things that you do. And she was talking to me about some doctors are stingy. They don't like treating people outside of the office because there's no money in it. But she was like, "No, they're missing it. Faithful in the small things." And this is so true about ministry too. You know, when I was younger, I used to think like, "Oh man, I gotta get to the big pulpits to give it all I have." But you know, my mom, like she was telling me, I was like, "Faithful in the small things." I was like, "All right." So I was like, all right, forget that. Then either one person or 100 people, I'm gonna go all out. You know, working at it. You know, my challenge to you guys is to be faithful in the small things. The training, whatever you do, it doesn't matter about what position it is being faithful to it. You know, most of us are, a lot of us are in our younger years, I think, or just starting out our things. There's a few veterans in here as well. But there's a temptation that we have not to do this. Some of you might even be dissatisfied with what you have, and I'm not really sure. Maybe some of you guys don't know what you're supposed to do. A lot of times, the lack of vision stops us from being faithful in the small things, right? Like, I don't know what I'm going to do anyway, so I'm not going to do anything. No. Whether it's in your studies or whether it's in a part-time job, it's faith being faithful in the small things. And God will open up different doors for you. Maybe the fact that you're there is simply to mold and shape your character, because that character is going to be the baseline necessity in all fields. Please, being faithful in the small things. And the next thing I want to leave you guys with is to be teachable. Teachable. You guys want to grow and steward the gifts that God has given you. Be teachable. I'm going to read to you guys from Proverbs 9:9. But in all actuality, if you guys read the entire book of Proverbs, the same thing comes up over and over again. Give instruction to a wise man and he will still be wiser. Teach a righteous man and he will increase in learning. The two things that you hear in the book of Proverbs, I've read Proverbs through over and over again, because every time I make a decision, I'm like, "Yeah, I gotta read the Proverbs." And, you know, I start reading it again. Over and over again, it talks about the person who is teachable always grows and has blessing. But the person who is not teachable, who can't take reproof, who doesn't like to listen, it's like worse off than, I don't know, they use a lot of different words. Those who think that they already good or perfect at what they do will never grow. They're stagnant and they'll soon be passed. It's better to be an incompetent learner who always strives to grow and learn rather than a pompous, talented individual who thinks he knows everything. I mean, there's a huge difference between a gallon of water versus drops of water that go on for eternity. Sometimes we look at the gallon of water, we're like, "Dang, this guy has so many talents," but no, drops of water overnight will fill an entire bathtub. It's the constant heart to learn. The lack of learning will not only limit you, but it will cripple you. Talent alone is not enough.
and must be trained. I knew so many students since my youth that were so-called proteges, and maybe you guys knew at least one or two of them, right? That dude that got a perfect SAT score without doing anything, and he's like, I never studied a day in my life, and he got a perfect score. So smart. That same dude went on to do nothing. How does it happen? You know, sometimes I think it's a curse to be smart. You know, it's better being the dumb guy that keeps trying and trying, then they end up somewhere, versus a smart guy that's like, oh, I'm smart. And that's why, like, the worst people are like the guys that are okay with like, I don't know, like a B, and they get B's their entire life because they know that doing the A is that much extra work and they'll never do it. But they can get a B without studying, so they never study. So I bet you there's some of you guys in this room that are like that. But being teachable, how hard is it at times to listen to somebody else's rebuke and advice? How hard is it to respond to it by not only listening, but to accepting it and challenging and changing? You know, these days, a natural reaction that I'm finding in our generation so much is this whole idea of being offended. I'm so offended. And once you're offended, what happens? You get your defenses up. People are so easily offended when they're challenged. Rather than taking it as an act of love to grow for the better. We have to be open to being offended and not get defensive, or we'll never grow. That is a teachable heart. And most practically is putting down your pride and humbly listening. In Los Angeles, I met a lot of different pastors. Our church was like a revolving door. It was a kind of a mega church model. So, like, you know, guys would come in and out, in and out. I was there for 5 years, but I was considered a veteran. Like, you pass a 3-year mark, they're like, oh my gosh, like, you stayed so long. But, you know, and I get it, they work you, man. I was at church like 5 to 11 every day. Like, it was the worst and best experience ever. Preaching in Korean and everything. But I met a lot of pastors during that time. And this was always a distinction between people that would hone their skills versus people that would just get offended and leave. There are people that we just could not work with because any suggestion that you give them, there was a personal attack from them. Oh, that's not my gifting. Why would you say that to me? Oh. If you take these moments to actually take it in to learn, you grow in the field that you're in, you grow in the heart, you grow in the different ministries that you're in. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying this like I'm any better than this guy. This guy is a nice guy. Nice guy. But he couldn't last a year because he couldn't take criticism. Couldn't last 1 year. And this led to something else. They began to only be surrounded by people who were so-called yes men and never being able to develop different leaders around them. This is not a leader that is confident. No, true confidence comes from a heart that is willing to listen, willing to take advice, even from a child. Be teachable. And the third thing I'm going to leave you with, and this is kind of going in a different way, you guys got to train and take care of your faith. Train and take care of your faith. This one is overlooked so much. I mean, we train in so many other areas in life. I mean, if we have a plant, we water it, we do all this, but our faith, a gift given from God, a lot of times just falls into the background. Faith is a gift given from God, and it has to be stewarded properly. Training our faith is building those habits of holding on to God's truth. Habits of holding on to God's truth. Yes, we know the gospel. We know the gospel. But do you know how to apply that gospel in the right places when your heart goes up and down? Then I realized a part of faith is preaching the gospel to yourself moment by moment. Preaching the gospel to yourself moment by moment. When you're lonely, preaching to yourself saying, Lord, I have you by my side. When you're feeling weak, preaching to yourself saying, it's not by my strength, but only God's strength. It's preaching to yourself every moment. It's not I accept God in my heart once and I'm saved and that's it. And then you're past that. No. Training your faith is learning how to preach to your life moment by moment. I mean, life has so many ups and downs. But faith is a consistency of trusting in God through it all. The world will mess with our emotions, trust me. Our passions will change depending on what we're going through. Our passions will go up and down. You know what's crazy? How many of you guys are scared of scary movies? Like, you're terrified of them. Like, you watch a zombie movie and you're scared that zombies might come out, or you watch a ghost movie and suddenly you can't go to the bathroom by yourself, or you gotta turn on all the lights in your house, or you watch, you know, like the boogeyman or something, and you're scared to look under your bed. But how many of you guys know in your mind, logically, that there is no zombies downstairs, there's no ghost that's gonna pop out, boogeyman is not under your bed, you know this. But why is it that your heart, at that moment, makes it feel like it's so real? You know what I realized about our faith? We know the gospel. We know the truth. But when the emotions go up and down, reality falls apart. A part of training our faith is at those moments, learning how to remind yourself of God's truth, His promises. What He has for you on a day-to-day basis. I mean, I realized that the heart and the body and the mind change differently. You know, when I first was introduced to the faith, they said the Christian God will change you completely through His Holy Spirit, and I thought it was like an automatic thing, like, oh my gosh, when I accept Christ, and suddenly I'm going to be the saint walking, all my habits will fall off of me, and I'm not going to be doing anything bad. You know, I'm going to look at hot girls, and they're going to look like rocks to me. You know what I realized? None of that happened. I've been walking as a Christian for my life. You know, still. Anyways. But it's a part of training yourself. The heart, body, and mind change differently. I mean, we're creatures of habit. We really are. You know, when driving to a place, I mean, you guys drive down the same place over and over again for a long time. I guarantee you, when you drive out of your driveway, if you're not thinking you're going to go to your work, and you're not even trying to go to work, but you just go to work, and you're like, what the heck am I doing? And then you make a U-turn and go to wherever. This is how habitual our hearts and even our bodies are. But if you live a life of sin over and over again, trust me, your habits are going to kick in, even though your heart may be somewhere else. And I realized our faith, our walk with God, it has to be disciplined. Just like what Paul says, it has to be beaten into your body until it's made a habit. Habits don't form just like that. It has to be beaten in. Our minds, just like we believe in boogeyman monsters after we watch a movie, it goes back to our fears so quickly. The idols of our hearts always kick in very, very fast. The fears that we have, our anxieties. You know, even as a pastor that preaches, oh, God is with me by myself, I get so anxious all the time. Like, I get all worried. It's these moments that we got to stop and be like, train your faith to be like, no, there is no anxiety in Christ. And even quoting a Bible verse to yourself, saying the peace of God that is beyond all understanding will cover my heart. And guys, those moment-by-moment trainings of turning your eyes back to truth, those are the things that build your faith. They build your faith. A lot of the times, I feel like we're little children, right? God gave us a gift, say like our father gave us this little seed. You know, there's a reason why I think they use God's word in the kind of analogy of a seed, because it's organic, it grows that way. God gave us a seed, He planted it into our hearts, this is faith. And God says, I give it to you, steward it. And He's saying, hey, this seed needs sunlight, this seed needs water, this seed needs fertilizer. This seed needs all these things. I give it to him. Feed it, nourish it, train it. But a lot of times, we're like the little boy that's just looking at the seed. We plant it into the ground, all crusty and whatnot, and we just look at it. We're like, God, why am I changing? I'm in a rut, God. What do I do? There's a reason why sometimes it takes a retreat to get your heart melting. If you guys are here, you guys are watering your seed. There's a reason why when you go out and serve and go on a mission trip, your heart is soaked with the things of God. because you're watering it. These are things that we have to constantly do, not only with God's word, but with the things of God through serving the church and working with them. Our faith grows when we feed it. I want to challenge you guys. Will you train your faith? Will you train your gifts? Be faithful in the small things. Be teachable to constantly grow, because God is constantly teaching us. Constantly teaching us. Over and over again, He's going to send different people in your life. Will you do it? We can never forget, but this is, I'm going to leave you guys with this, but we can never forget the context that we do it all in. You know, I think Pastor Mike quoted this Bible verse. I think it was you that you said this. This is Philippians 3:12. Not that I have already obtained this or am perfect or already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me His own. And this reminds us of our true motivation, that we run and we train not because we're seeking to be loved through our efforts, but because we are already loved by God.
Amen.
We press on to make this our own because Christ Jesus has made us our own. We run this race not because we have to win the race, but we run the race knowing that we have already won it.
Amen.
And we're getting the prize. We are simply called to run to Him and to the finish line and receive it. I'm gonna preach this quote to you by John Piper. There's a sermon called like Olympic Faith, and like the whole thing is like coming, like it's beautiful. But let me read this to you guys. He says this: the way we live our lives has eternal consequences. Life is a proving ground where we prove who we are, whom we trust, and what we cherish. Make no mistake here, life is not a place for proving to God or anybody your strength. Life is a place for proving whose strength you trust, man's or God's. Life is not a place for proving the power of your intelligence to know truth. It's a place for proving the power of God's grace to show truth. Life is not a field for demonstrating the force of our will to make good choices. It's a field for showing how the beauty of Christ takes us captive and moves us to choose and run for His glory. The race of life has eternal consequences, not because we're saved by works, but because Christ has saved us from dead works to serve the living and the true God with Olympic passion. The race of life has eternal consequences, not because grace is nullified by the way we run, but because grace is verified by the way we run.
Amen.
I want to ask you guys to be challenged. As we walk this Christian life, it's not to stand around being like, hey God, like when are you going to make this happen? He is making it happen. He's knocking on your door. Will you take steward me? Will you be a steward of the gifts that I have given you? You guys, once you guys start tapping into that, He's going to take you on a whole nother one. Let's pray.